What's up, motherfuckers? This is your African King of Comedy, Michael Blackson. You're watching Real Friends Real Talk. Get real with it, motherfuckers.
Face facts, what up?
Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man.
Jay-Z still getting backlash from his NFL and Roc Nation deal.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you guys feel like this is unfolding right now?
I said last week, I stand with Jay. I support everything Jay's got going on. I don't buy into the narrative that he's a sellout. Yeah. His track record proves otherwise. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of fake outrage. Yeah. You know, people just want to be mad about something.
Yeah.
You know, you got NFL players like Kenny Stills, like Eric Reed, who are voicing their displeasure with the collab of Roc Nation and the NFL. But them guys are still cashing NFL checks.
Yeah.
Right? They still reporting to minicamp. They still good employees all the way through it. So you can't knock Jay for trying to bring change when I thought that's what you wanted. You wanted change.
And I think just knowing his track record of doing so much for the community, you have to have faith that he's going to turn this around. And it's interesting that the players have anything to say because, like you said, they're still getting a check. So technically they're hypocritical if they want to, you know, be the ones criticizing him.
Yeah. Well, first of all, you know, that's Brooklyn right there. You know I'm always going to support Brooklyn. So that's, you know, so shout out to Jay anyway because, he, you know, he's always taking it to the next level. But, yeah, as far as the players go, Eric Reed and I know Kenny Stills has some stuff to say about it. You know, first of all, I'd like to know, have you actually had any kind of dialogue with Jay-Z in regards to exactly what his plans are? Because nobody knows at this point just yet. You know, I'm sure he knows, but as far as the rest of us, we don't even know. That's number one. Number two, you know, like you said, with, you know, you guys are still cashing NFL checks. And I know one of the things that Eric Reed said, one of the statements he made was, oh, you made this deal, but Kaepernick doesn't have a job yet in the NFL. So my thing to that is, you getting a check from the NFL right now, and he doesn't have a job in the NFL. So why are you not standing to the sidelines? You still, your paycheck, like you said, still says, you know, it has the NFL on it. Your owner's name is on that paycheck. So how are you going to come at Jay, who has been known for at least 20 years for the work that he's done in the community? You know, I told you guys earlier today when we had the group chat, you know, I wrote my senior thesis in 2006, and I was talking about all of the things that different rappers have been doing in the community from that point. And so we're talking about, you know, what, 12 years, you know, and since then. And now, I mean, you know about the water in Africa and all of that. You know, there's a lot of things that you know that Jay-Z does, but there's a lot of things that people don't know that Jay does and that goes, you know, that goes under the radar. Obviously, you know, we know, you know, the Reform Act. We know he helped Meek out of his situation. We know he helped 21 Savage, you know, because those are the big headlines.
Yeah.
But Jay-Z has been doing work in the community for a long time, you know, one. And two, who better to represent for us than Jay-Z, who, you know, and not to take away anything from Kaepernick, because I completely supported the kneeling, but at the end of the day, Kaepernick grew up in the suburbs in Wisconsin. Jay-Z is from Mossy Projects. So who better to represent for us than someone who is actually
from
where we're from?
To me, Eric Reed, I just don't understand his anger with everything. Because, I mean, we saw last year him run across the field to try to get the Malcolm Jenkins, who's part of the Player Coalition, who they themselves have been working behind the scenes to try to implement change. And
he did it right before the game.
Right. Crazy. And then to, like, the calls the scene before the game and then to speak out the way he's speaking out now, to me, is like, all right, cool. You don't like Jay in this position. All right. But then what's your plan?
Right.
Yeah.
What are you doing that we're not seeing, or what are you bringing to the table that can initiate change? Because if you just outraged at anybody else who's trying to bring change, then you're not helping the situation.
Yeah.
And I think that a lot of people are going off of headlines. They're not actually even looking up what the deal is.
Exactly.
And I spent some time reading it, and basically the entertainment part of it, he's going to pick entertainers that their music is going to be streamed during NFL commercials and things like that. Then those entertainers have to pick out of 5 social issues and community. So, and the proceeds will go to that.
Yeah.
So, and one of them being police brutality.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's, if you actually read the deal, then you know it's actually very positive. And the Inspire to Change Act has been something that was already a part of the NFL. They're just kind of revamping it.
Right.
And actually getting someone from our community to actually have a voice in it and have a seat at the table.
Right. And I think one of the first thing we saw right away shows where Jay's mindset is with this. He made Roger Goodell sit front and center and answer some tough questions that Roger Goodell has been kind of ducking and dodging in the past.
Right.
So Jay wants to implement change, but we've got to give them the opportunity to do it as well. We just can't criticize it
because like they announced the deal and 5 minutes later, nah, you just sell out. You know what I'm saying?
You can't criticize just because you don't understand something doesn't mean you just start criticizing and like, nah, it ain't gonna work.
And one thing that has bothered me about this whole debate is, I think oftentimes as a people, we can be easily divided. Yeah. And I feel like it went from us, everyone, being on the same page about police brutality to now it's like you're team Cap or you're team Jay-Z. Yeah. And I think that's the issue that bothers me because as a people, we're always getting divided, even back in our history. And I think we have to kind of shift our thinking and know that they both have the same goal to evoke change or incite change. So I think that's like the bigger picture that I noticed. So
yeah. Well, listen, you know, at this point, we're going to sit back and, you know, we're going to let Hov do what he does. Yeah. And because at the end of the day, you know, this is not like something where we're not going to actually know what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, see everything.
Exactly. We're going to see it unfold in front of our eyes. So sit back. Give Jay a chance. I mean, if anybody can make that kind of an impact, it's definitely Jay-Z.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm, you know, again, we support him.
Definitely.
You know, and, I mean, shout out to Cap as well, you know. But, you know, at the end of the day, you got somebody that's stepping up. You lit the torch, and now Jay took it and said, all right, this is what we're going to do. You know, because, you know, sometimes and people forget, you know, yeah, change is great. But at the same time, you can't make change unless you're willing to sit down with people and try to come to some sort of a collective. And that's what Jay-Z is doing. All right, you know, yeah, we seen what Cap did. And like he said, you know, yeah, but at some point we got to stop kneeling and we got to actually really dig in and start making moves.
Listen,
well, you have to have a seat at the table to even be a part of the conversation. And that's the part that everyone is missing. But to have a seat at the table, you have to be able to compromise and discuss both, you know, point of views. So
That conversation, like you said, can only take place if you're at the table. And I just want to reference, we talked about Meek and Jay's relationship. In a recent Meek documentary, Michael Rubin, who's the owner of the Sixers, he openly talked about not understanding Meek's struggle until they became close friends. And he saw what he dealt with on a day-to-day basis. A lot of these owners don't come from the backgrounds we come from.
It's a disconnect.
Right? So there's a major disconnect.
Yeah.
So you've got to be able to be in front of their face and really show them what goes on if you want them to change.
Yeah.
If you think kneeling is going to automatically force a billionaire to change his ways, it's not happening.
Yeah.
I actually just this weekend, I was speaking to a police officer that's NYPD. And I was telling him why there's such a disconnect in our community with police. And I told him how, obviously, you guys know I live in Long Island.
You suburban dude.
And one of my friends who grew up in the next town next to me, he became NYPD. But he grew up in a very predominantly white suburb. He's Dominican. He ended up getting his first job in Southside Jamaica, Queens. Somewhere he's completely foreign to, knew nothing about the culture, already had preconceived notions of the people and of the atmosphere and everything. So he already went into that job with a slated view of all these. He looked at the people, all these animals, these projects. These are things that he said. So you are the person now policing an environment that you
people.
Know nothing about culturally. You're already going to have preconceived notions of people. So that's kind of part of that disconnect of even vetting police officers.
Yeah.
But it's the same thing.
And I mean, and you know, so that's, at the end of the day, he's still a minority. So.
And he's Dominican.
Yeah. So.
And he had a disconnect.
Yeah.
So imagine, you know, white men that are looking at young black men that live in America that they're not even used to.
I mean, Robert Kraft, I think he got it now. He got the Dream Chaser chain and whatnot. I think he's like kind of rocking with us. No, he's not with us no more. Yeah. We cool with him? Are we cool with Robert Kraft? Oh, because he got the situation still?
Nah, I always like Robert Kraft. Or? I mean, he got the rub and tug and he was running around with the DC chain. Robert Kraft good with me.
All right, do we good? Do
listen, it's a whole different culture in New England because, you know, can we keep it on NFL for a little bit?
Go ahead. So go ahead and talk about it. Then,
right,
man.
You know what I'm saying? We just saw Patrick Chung get caught up on a cocaine possession.
No.
Cocaine. Robert Kraft is getting rubbing tugs before playoff games.
Yeah, I mean, they don't talk about Aaron Hernandez.
No, I mean, it's a wild locker room. It's a wild locker room over there.
Those are the real cocaine cowboys in New England.
It's wild.
This is Deontay the Bronze Bummer Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world. And you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
Real Fans Real Talk.com. Where Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not.